The New York Times said, reviewer said that World Order is a book that every member of Congress should be locked in a room with and forced to read before taking the oath of office. Don't let the tantalizing title or the provocative jacket art mislead you. This is a very exciting book. It's as timely as tomorrow's headlines. It's wise and sophisticated, but it's completely accessible to the interested layman. Some of the chapters, like those dealing with China and Russia and Islam and America, are masterpieces of a synthesis and analysis. And the chapter, the final chapter, on the internet, or on technology, and particularly the impact of the internet on our world today, is should be required reading. Matter of fact, I would change the Times reviewer's criterion and say that every American should be locked in a room with a copy of World Order and forced at the very least to read that final chapter about the internet before the next time they go online. We'll talk about World Order shortly, but I thought I would divide our very limited time into thirds. And since we're in Yorba Linda in the East Room at the Nixon Library, I thought I would ask you some questions about Richard Nixon and your relationship with him, and then move on to World Order. And then if there's any time left, perhaps ask some questions about the application of the principles of World Order to the very real problems we're facing today all around the world, from Ebola to ISIS. So to begin with Nixon. How did Richard Nixon and Henry Kissinger become the 20th century's diplomatic, dynamic duo? The Vice President Nixon wrote you a fan letter in 1958 when your sensational book, Nuclear Weapons and Foreign Policy, was published, and Claire Booth Luce arranged a meeting, brief meeting with you at her apartment in New York. But the next and second time you meet him is in the Pierre Hotel when he is president-elect and he offers you, or he appears to think he offers you, the position as his national security advisor. What do you remember of that meeting?
Well, if anyone had predicted to me or anyone, say, at the beginning of 68, that at the end of 68, I would have been appointed national security advisor to Richard Nixon, that would have been considered mad. I had met him, as you pointed out, Frank, for 10 seconds at a Christmas party in Claire Booth Luce's house. He was coming in as I was going out. He had written me a very friendly letter in 58 about my book, Nuclear Weapons and Foreign Policy. And I guess I answered it politely, and I'm sure I answered it politely. But for most of that period, from 58 to 68, I was the foreign policy advisor of Nelson Rockefeller, who contested the nomination. He was a competitor for the nomination in three times. And so when I was invited to meet with Nixon, he sort of reviewed the international situation with me. One of the essences of Richard Nixon was that he was very diffident in his personal relationships, and that he wanted to avoid situations in which he might be rejected. So by the end of that first meeting, I knew he wanted something, but I didn't know what. So I went back to Harvard, and a week later, John Mitchell called me up and said, "Well, are you going to take the job or not?" And I said, "What job?" And Mitchell said, "Oh my God, he screwed it up." So I was called back, and this time he offered me the job. And this is no credit to me, but I was an arrogant Harvard professor. So I said, I've been opposing you, or at any rate, I've been on the other side for the last 10 years. I'd like to think about it. He should have told me to get lost at that point. He said, take a week. And the person who saved the situation was Nelson Rockefeller, who, when I told him about it the next day, said, has it ever occurred to you that Nixon is taking a bigger risk on you than you on him? It was absolutely true. But so anyway, from this, you'd say unpromising beginning.
Unlikely beginning.
From the first day that I walked into the office, Nixon didn't treat me as being on trial, or he treated me as his chief advisor. And the essence of Nixon, the quality of Nixon's foreign policy was that he was a very reflective man. He would sit he had a little hideaway, or not a little, but he had a hideaway office in the executive office building in the State Department, old State Department building. And he'd sit there for hours with yellow pads, having read books or memos and thinking through the issues. And what he liked to do is to get me in and discuss how to think about these things. But at the same time, he had a great capacity to make important decisions. And I would say over those years, I think back of them to them with enormous pride. And in the book that Frank Gannon was kind enough to mention, I devote I go through various presidencies that I had considered. I list him together with Teddy Roosevelt as the two most seminal presidents of foreign policy in the way I believe foreign policy should be considered.
How do you think that happened? How did essentially shy and not worldly, certainly at the beginning, a man from Yorba Linda, which was not then the hub of international activity that it has become, how did he develop, or how did he get this almost instinctual feeling for foreign policy?
You see, you all have to remember one thing. I didn't know Richard Nixon before 1969. After that, I probably locked more time with him in the presidency than anybody else. And after that, I saw him regularly, but not accidentally. How did he get there? Someday, somebody is going to write a great book on Richard Nixon, because his personality has been totally elusive. One interpretation I have is that he was put into positions, first of all, he's always very reflective. He read a lot of books, and he liked to travel. And so when he was vice president, he did a lot of traveling. And since he didn't really like small talk, and you couldn't even argue he didn't have any small talk, he got involved in a lot of substantive conversations. And so he learned what the various people were thinking. And being reflective, he asked himself, why are they thinking that way? And so he arrived in the office with an extraordinary knowledge. Most of the time, candidates spend all their time on fundraising and on taking positions for Sunday talk shows. But he arrived with a very crystallized view on foreign policy. You can read, for example, on the way when I was on the way to China. So this was not a speech I even knew he was giving. He made a speech in Kansas City explaining his perception of international affairs. And nobody knew that I was even on a trip. And but he...
Didn't Zhou Enlai inform you of that,
yes,
of
actually,
that speech?
Yes, actually, you're right.
He gave you the news.
I learned about that speech by being told by Zhou Enlai on my first evening there that we were very impressed, he said, by President Nixon's speech in Kansas City. Well, he was way ahead of me. I didn't know what he had said. But what he had said was he described an international environment which involved a balance of power. And he listed in that environment China and Russia, which under the Cold War scheme, they were enemies. But he listed them as essential elements of the system and how that might evolve over the years. No president today would give such a speech. And that was one of the many unique aspects of it.
Before I ask you what working with Richard Nixon was like, we have a couple of clips from some interviews I did with him in 1983 in which he talks about what working with you was like. And the first one deals with the 2nd of May, May 2nd, 1971. He's in the Lincoln sitting room after a state dinner working. He's still in his tuxedo. You're in the Situation Room in the White House, and word comes through that the Chinese government is going to invite Nixon to China. And you have to get from the Situation Room in the basement of the West Wing to the Lincoln sitting room on the second floor of the family quarters. This is how he described it.
He must have run all the way from the Situation Room, which is about 200 yards away from the sitting room and the residence. And he said, "This is the most important message between heads of government since World War II." And then he read the message. As I read it, he beamed, and the message in effect said, we'll welcome the President of the United States to meet with Zhou Enlai, and then we will also welcome Dr. Kissinger to come to prepare for the meeting." And he said, this message, he had a, with their great sense of humor and their subtlety, it ended with an interesting clause. He says, "This message is somewhat different from the usual diplomatic message because it's from a head, to a head, through a head. From a head, head of state or government, Zhou Enlai. Through a head, of course, was Yahya Pakistan, to a head. The message, of course, since we had no relations with China, didn't come from the Chinese. The Pakistani ambassador had delivered it to Henry Kissinger and then Kissinger to me. So it was from ahead, through ahead, to ahead."
Did Zhou Enlai putting that kind of, whatever you would call it, grace note into that message, did that have any significance, or was it just sort of representative of his mind?
No, it was, you have to remember, Nixon came into office determined to find a way to at least exchange ideas with the Chinese. But that was easier said than done because the Chinese were in the middle of the Cultural Revolution and they had recalled all their ambassadors from around the world. There was only one ambassador left, that was the one in Cairo, with which we didn't have diplomatic relations in the aftermath of the 67 war. So we tried various possible approaches to get a message to the Chinese. For example, when Nixon, at the state funeral of de Gaulle, there was a reception in the Elysee Palace for heads of state. And the Chinese ambassador was there. And Nixon said to me, "If you can get him alone for a moment, walk up to him and tell him we want a dialogue. Well, if I had done that, he was never alone for a moment, so I couldn't deliver that message. That would have been a sensation, that a presidential assistant talks to a Chinese ambassador. But so 3 months later, we were in Pakistan, and Nixon told the Pakistan president, who he knew, and Pakistan did have diplomatic relations with China, that same thing. He wanted a dialogue with China. We also tried Romania, where Nixon was on the same trip. Actually, we went from Pakistan to Romania, thinking that maybe they would be more open to a message from a communist country. That was a mistake in the sense that if the Chinese distrusted anyone, it was a communist country. So the Chinese picked up that message from Yahya via the Pakistan president and sent that message. Actually, in his conversation with you, Nixon consolidated several messages that the Chinese had said. Everything he described happened, but in maybe two messages. Their first response was, we take this seriously because it came from a head, through a head, to a head, and we want a dialogue based on the proposition that Taiwan has to go back to China. Nixon replied, we want a dialogue, but nobody can determine the agenda. So we want to talk about the things that are on our mind, and you can talk about the things that are on your mind. And out of this then crystallized a message from the Chinese, which in effect invited him to come and invited me to come for a preparatory visit. But you have to remember this was a sensational event at that time because very few countries recognized China at all. There would have been strong opposition in this country. Nixon did this on his own. And this is not a question you asked, but to understand Nixon's reaction, say, to the Pentagon Papers, you have to understand that we were negotiating these things with the Chinese at the same time, and we didn't want to create the impression that we were a country that couldn't keep any secrets. So anyway, this is how the dialogue evolved. But you have to understand the enormous courage for Nixon to send his personal assistant to China. The way these messages were delivered was the Chinese wrote them out on paper, on a piece of paper, which was then delivered by a Pakistani messenger. And we typed our answers on a paper that had no watermarks on it, and unsigned. And out of this then developed my visit to China. And at the first meeting with Zhou Enlai, he called my attention to that Kansas City speech. And that was important because there were 100 or so issues between us and China. But what was important at that moment was to make sure that the two sides understood where they were going. So the philosophical and conceptual part was more important than the tactical part.
Today, every step of your secret trip to Beijing would have been on Twitter, and all your meals would have been Instagrammed.
People were saying that we liked secrecy. if we had announced that trip ahead of time, we would have had to give assurances to God knows how many governments. We would have had to do congressional briefings of what we would never do or what we might do. There would have been a big debate before we ever had exchanged one sentence with the Chinese. And I would say that the greatest contribution that Nixon and his administration made was not just getting security advisor to China, but it was, there was a long agenda of claims and assets, of money things, endless agenda. Nixon said, let's not talk about these items. Let's talk about what are we trying to do. So if you read the dialogue between Zhou Enlai and me on the first visit, it sounds like two college professors discussing the nature of international politics. And I might mention one other thing that might amuse you. I would say every visitor to China was fighting for the privilege of meeting Mao. I was the only one who came to China determined not to meet Mao because I knew that Nixon wanted to reserve that for himself. We found out afterwards that Mao had given instructions that if as soon as I asked, I was to be brought to him. But I valued my relationship with Nixon more than that news, that opportunity. And I never asked for a meeting. And it was appropriate because when Nixon met Mao, Mao said something to Nixon that he couldn't have said to anyone else. He said, we don't need Taiwan for 100 years. There's just a bunch of revolutionaries there. And he said, we'll settle it in 100 years. Well, that meant we were not under pressure. And that the biggest seeming obstacle was removed.
If we could skip one clip, there's a clip from the dealing with the Soviet summit, the first summit in Moscow in 1972. And when you were there, you knew that every place you went, every room, every automobile was at least bugged and possibly bugged and filmed. And both. And the president took was amused in describing the way in which you let them know that you knew.
Well, this Kissinger's meeting with Gromyko, and he told me about this later with great glee, because Henry has a very good sense of humor. He's a very serious negotiator, but he's got a sharp sense of humor, and he uses it effectively. And he said he and Gromyko were talking, and Gromyko, when he saw this piece of paper that they were discussing that Henry had brought along, he said he'd like to have copies. And so Henry took the piece of paper and held it up to the chandelier and said, 6 copies, please.
Is a good sense of humor a useful quiver in the diplomats?
Well, I think a sense of humor shows that you have a sense of proportion about events, and that you can see the sometimes a ludicrous aspect. And also it gives you a way to put something forward that you wouldn't want to state as a formal assertion. And that was one of these things where I said, if I hold this up to the ceiling, could I get 6 copies? But I have to say Gromyko was equal to the challenge. He didn't say there were no cameras. He said the cameras were installed by the Tsars. They are very good in getting people, but not so good on documents.
One last question about President Nixon before we move on to world order. On August 8th, 1974, the day he resigned, you, after that speech, you walked back with him from the Oval Office to the residence, and your parting words to him were that history would judge him as one of the great presidents. And he said, that depends, Henry, on who writes the history. 40 years have passed. Historians are still at work. How do you, 40 years later, how do you think history will treat Richard Nixon?
They will treat him as one of the seminal presidents. And it's already starting, because what was the fundamental problem for the United States? Alone among the great countries, the United States could conduct its foreign policy without a sense of foreign danger. We were protected behind two great oceans. Then, after 1945, we were so materially superior that foreign policy really was conducted like domestic policy, that you assembled resources to meet a problem. In his in the Nixon presidency, we came up against a situation where nuclear weapons had grown to such an extent that the traditional notions of warfare were almost impossible to apply. Then you had Russia, that was both ideological and a superpower. Then you had China, which was outside the international system. You had Europe reconstituting itself. And you had America, which remained the single most powerful country and the indispensable country. But it now had to think of foreign policy differently, in this sense. Historically, we could say, if you look at American proposals, they were always with a time limit, that every problem had a solution, and within a time limit. Nixon was the first president who had to deal with a foreign policy which would never end, and which consisted, importantly, of placing America in a position where, to put it crudely, we were closer to everyone else than they were to each other. That magnified our bargaining position. Now, he understood that, and he set a pattern. You were kind enough to mention the opening to China. I think to bring about the switch of Egypt from a Soviet alliance to, in effect, an American alliance, which also happened and which revolutionized the Middle East and which set the policies for about 40 years, was in many ways as big an event. And so when that is studied, free of the animosities and disputes that characterized some of the last period of the Nixon presidency, it will be understood that he was one of the most important presidents, in especially in the foreign policy field. But Nixon had a principle that was very important and from which I personally learned quite a bit. It was very simple. It said, you pay the same price for doing something halfway as for doing it completely. So you might as well do it completely. And that sort of took you away from the hedging approach to foreign policy and obliged you to think, what are we really trying to do here? And then you could assess. So that's what I think history will increasingly say about him.
You are generally and properly thought of as a world statesman, but you are also a notable and a very prolific author, beginning in, among other, many other, I think by my count, 17 books and counting, beginning in 1954 with your Harvard dissertation, A World Restored, in 58, the seminal and controversial Nuclear Weapons and Foreign Policy, three brilliant and voluminous volumes of memoirs of the White House and State Department years in the 70s, And then in 1994, diplomacy, in which you describe Nixon, the Nixon-Kissinger relationship vividly, on China in 1911, and now world order in 1914. Why do you write, and for whom do you write?
It's a really good question, because
that's why I'm here.
And I have to give you an inadequate answer. I have never questioned why I should write. It's been sort of a compulsion. I wrote an undergraduate thesis of 300 pages.
And very modestly titled.
Yeah, it's called The Meaning of History. So I have always thought that I had a mission, obligation, to write. I write for people who are concerned about foreign policy. And by that, I don't mean the tacticians of foreign policy. I mean people who think that their life is affected in one way or another by foreign policy. And it ought to be a larger and larger group. But once I'm finished with the book, I don't know what your experience is. I'm really done with it. You have to do some selling of it immediately afterwards. But then I think I've done all I can do on that topic. And I usually don't return to it.
You dedicated on China in 2011 to Oscar and Annette de Laurentiis. Oscar de la Renta, the designer and philanthropist, died on Monday. Why did you make that dedication, and how do you remember him?
Well, Oscar was a man of enormous charm, elegance, and concern, who had done many extraordinarily creative things. We fell into the habit of spending the period between Christmas and New Year, the Christmas holidays, together. The last decade, increasingly at his place in the Dominican Republic. And they also had a house near us in Connecticut. So they were really part of our lives. And I suppose everybody needs people in their lives that represent a world that they do not share fully. So Oscar did this for me about the world of grace and elegance and thoughtfulness. And I may have done it for him in the world of policy making. And he really was an integral part of our life. And as it happened, I started actually both of these books, both the On China book and this book, 3 years apart in Punta Cana, his place in the Dominican Republic. And he had arranged a little library for me. And so, and the atmosphere was relaxing. And he always invited groups of interesting people. So this was a stimulating. But we saw a lot of each other also here. And it makes both Nancy's and my life a lot emptier to be without him. But on the other hand, we had the benefit and privilege of decades of knowing him. and it gives us an edge over those who don't share our current sorrow because they didn't know him so well.
In World Order, you talk a lot about the Peace of Westphalia. What is it? What was it? What does it mean to us in America today?
You see, American statesmen and writers keep saying there's a world order. And you see it now in Ukraine. It's Russia has violated international law by crossing borders. But if you look at it historically, first, there has never been a world order because the various continents conducted their foreign policy in isolation from each other. The Roman Empire knew next to nothing about the Chinese Empire and vice versa. And the Islamic world has always been a world substantially apart. Most regions, all regions except Europe, have been organized as empires, as some form of empire. The Chinese didn't even know there was an idea of sovereignty did not exist in China. It was unknown in China until the end of the 19th century. Now, the peculiar aspect of Europe is that it was broken up into a group of states of more or less equal size who achieved order not by the direction of an emperor, but by the balance of power and by a common sense of what is a fair arrangement. So you had international law and balance of power, peculiar to Europe. Then it was spread around the world by colonialism. So now we are in a world. So now what was the Westphalian Treaty? In the beginning of the 17th century, when Protestantism emerged, Europe was seized by a number of wars that had many origins, but one of them was religion. And the big war was whether the Catholic believers could return Europe to the dominance, and the Protestant ones fought for autonomy. And then after 30 years of warfare that killed a third of the population of Central Europe, they made a peace which said it is up to each country to determine its religion. And therefore, the notion of sovereignty could be developed, and foreign policy could be defined, or aggression could be defined as crossing borders. And we've become so used to that. So the order we know is the Westphalian order. But now that order is in crisis because the Westphalian order depends on the existence of states. But in many parts of the world, the state is disintegrating. In Libya, in Yemen, in Syria, in many parts of the world, religious conflicts are more important than state conflicts. In some parts of the world, the borders that were established are in question. So this makes this an especially turbulent period.
You write that in World Order, you write that the Westphalian system requires that states have a strategy to pursue and protect their interests. Does don't do stupid stuff qualify as a Westphalian strategic goal?
No.
Enough said.
It requires no explanation. No.
America and most of the other world democracies view the world through Westphalian terms. But you describe in these chapters on Russia and China and Islam their different views. About Russia, for example, you write that from Peter the Great to Vladimir Putin, circumstances have changed, but the rhythm has remained extraordinarily consistent. What does that mean, and what does it mean to us as we look at Putin, Ukraine, Russia today?
We have to remember that when Europe was going through the age of discovery, Russia was freeing itself from a Mongolian occupation that had lasted 300 years. When Europe was beginning the Enlightenment, Russia was undergoing a tremendous domestic turmoil to establish a central authority. So you have in Russia a huge territory that has been, that on the one hand had started more wars than almost any other, but also has preserved the balance of power in the world by its resistance to first Mongolian invasions from the east, Swedish invasions, French invasions, German invasions. So that has been a historic role for Russia. The rulers of Russia have always been people that were perceived by the public as being of superhuman stature, dominating a region to this vast extent. And even when the people were terribly treated, they always blamed the bureaucracy, never the Tsar. And so the government, in that sense, Stalin is a continuation of Peter the Great, Elizabeth the Great, and most of the Chinese, of the Russian reformers, have been absolutist rulers who nevertheless brought progressive sort of ideas into Russia. So when we look at Ukraine, correctly, it's a state that is being attacked. When Russia looks at Ukraine, it says the security border of our security border has been moved from the Elbe to 200 miles from Stalingrad. And we are used to having a big buffer between us and potential rivals. So we are absolutely right in insisting on the notion of sovereignty. But they have a point. And what I had hoped, and which has not happened, is that we have some discussion on this point and to see whether Ukraine could become a bridge rather than an outpost for either side. Because if it's an outpost of the West, you have that Stalingrad problem. If it's an outpost of the East, then the Russians are again at the borders of Poland, Hungary, and that's also not acceptable. So this is where I would hope that evolution goes, because you can't look at it entirely through the specter of the Westphalian thing. But on the other hand, the Russians cannot claim a right that every time they feel threatened, they grab a piece of some territory.
You, moving to China, we're having to move very quickly now. You describe the various differences between the Westphalian, the Western, the American view, and the Chinese view. You have a way with words, and you give a very good example of, or acute example of that difference. You say, in world order, you say, Americans hold that every problem has a solution. Chinese think that each solution is an admission ticket to a new set of problems. What's the prospect for Chinese-American relations? How are they now, and how do you see them developing?
Right now, we are doing okay on solving very practical problems. But we haven't had the fundamental dialogue. If you look at the conversations when Nixon was in China, he spent 3 days discussing American purposes with Zhou Enlai. The trouble is, we come forward usually with a solution to a problem which we define. The Chinese have a sort of a conceptual approach. Now, they are going through a very difficult period of reform right now. So I think they want a relative period of peace and quiet. But it would be important for you to use that period of peace to develop some response to something the Chinese president has said, which is we ought to try to develop a pattern by which two potential adversaries become a form of cooperative relationship. We have said it, the Chinese have said it, we have been able to give it enough content. And that's where there is on both sides. But if we don't give it content, and if we keep sliding into a confrontation with China over a period of years, then we're going to have a situation like World War I, where after the, if you look at World War I, none of the leaders who started that war would have done it if they had known what the world looked like in 1918. So we really have to protect ourselves, and they have to protect themselves against inadvertence. But how to approach this in a period in which running the government is so time-consuming, running for election is a full-time job, how you can also think about this problem, that's a challenge that is relatively new in our period.
In the section on Islam, the chapter, you write about our approach to Islamic radicalism. In a failure of imagination, many Western elites find revolutionaries' passions inexplicable and assume that their extreme statements must be metaphorical or advanced merely as bargaining chips. Yet for Islamic fundamentalists, these views represent truths overriding the rules and norms of the Westphalian or indeed any other international order. Is that still, how much of a problem is that still today? And has it been changed by the repugnance over the ISIS, over ISIS and particularly its videos?
Well, what Islamic state countries that are organized as states can understand Westphalian concepts. But the ISIS is trying to overthrow existing states in the name of a universal principle. And the trend in the Islamic world has been more towards the caliphate idea. I saw in today's newspaper that Tunisia, which has been considered one of the more Western countries, is one of the biggest recruiting places for ISIS. And that shows that there are some currents going on in the Islamic world that are that go back to the old universal principles. The first wave of Islamic conquerors gave their new subjects three choices: to convert, to become, be taxed but outside the legal system, or to be killed. And that's what ISIS is trying to do.
It's hard for me to believe that we've come to the end of our hour. Thank you again for writing this extraordinary book and for talking about it today. I have one last question. You're very long and in your very exceptional and happily very long life. You have embodied and reflected the story and the history of our times. As a young refugee from Nazi terror, you emigrated to America. In America, you became a student, a soldier, a renowned teacher, a distinguished scholar, the National Security Advisor to the President of the United States, and American Secretary of State. You became a Nobel laureate and the recipient of the Presidential Medal of Freedom. You are the American dream. We've talked today about how America has changed and how it's changing. You have children, grandchildren. What do you tell them? What do you want them and the grandchildren and the great-grandchildren to come? What do you want them to know about America?
Well, there's no other country where it would have been possible to have this trajectory. I was working in a shaving brush factory when I came here. If anyone had said at some point you'd be Secretary of State, it would have been inconceivable. So I noticed that in a lot of current education, the failures of America are stretched more than the promise of America. And so I'd like them to know what America represents. When I lived in Germany as a member of a discriminated minority, I had no idea who Franklin Roosevelt was, but somehow in my mind, I was 14, 15, he was a kind of salvation, even though I couldn't have described to you exactly. So that hope of America has to be maintained, and that the cynical domestic dispute in which people wallow in some American failing. The second thing, and there I couldn't help them at all, is that chapter I wrote on the internet. The world changed when printing was invented and has never been the same. The world changed when the internet became dominant. You can't abolish it, obviously, but one has to understand that it leads to a fragmentation. It enables you to collect more information, but it leads to a fragmentation of perception, because when you learn from books, you have to form concepts because you can't possibly remember everything you've read. When you learn from the internet, you can get an answer every time you press a button. And therefore, you can learn the superficial aspect of a problem, but you don't have an incentive to learn the deeper aspects. And so, I also think that these social networks and so forth, they're all great fun, but they produce a kind of narcissism where people watch themselves with great rapture to see what they might do next and feel they have to communicate that. So I'd just like them to have a little perspective on this. But I have to say they, on the other hand, have a measure of contempt for somebody whose knowledge of the internet is as fragmentary as mine is. We're in a revolutionary period, and I'd like it to be elevated by a higher sense of purpose than we get out of our normal means of communication. And thank you for the kind of questions you asked.
Thank you.
Are you